Amen. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all this morning. Let's all stand, please. Grab our blue songbooks. We're going to go to number 24. And can it be that I should gain? Number 24, as we all stand and stretch to begin our service this morning. Welcome to Harvest Baptist Church on this fine Sunday morning. Join me again. Number 24, 24. We'll sing all three verses. Think of the words that you sing. Sing it out with me on the first. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me, who caused his pain for me, who him to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? He left his Father's throne above, so he saw infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? On the third, long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's nigh. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke the dungeon flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I rose, went forth, and followed thee. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Say amen if you're happy you're saved. Amen. It's good to see everybody this morning on this beautiful, beautiful day. Praise the Lord for that. Let's remain standing and we'll open up with a word of prayer. And then we can be seated afterwards. Brother Tony, do you mind opening us up in prayer, please, sir? Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let's go again to our blue songbook, to number 448. Brethren, we have met to worship. We'll sing the first, third, and the fourth verse. Number 448. Think of the words as we sing. On the first, brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? All is vain unless the Spirit of the Holy One comes down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around.
brothers, will you join and help us? Moses' sister aided him. You help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin. Tell them all about the Savior. Tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around.
Amen, amen. What a great message. A few announcements before we continue. Don't forget, be in prayer for the Pee Wee Club starting this in September, the first Sunday night of September. It's for our little ones on Sunday nights that come, so be in prayer for them. And if you know of any other little ones who might enjoy being a part of the Pee Wee Club, please talk to them about it and bring them. We'd love to have them. My wife will be directing that, and they were going to have a lot of fun, so be in prayer for that. Also, ladies, they have their ensemble. Not tonight. No ensemble practice for the ladies tonight. And after the service, we will have the food pantry open. Please, we just got a new load on Thursday, and there's some great stuff in there. Please, everybody stop by and take some. I know times are hard, but it's there all the time, and if it goes bad, then we have to throw it away. And there's a lot of good stuff. So please stop by and enjoy that. If you know of somebody who would be blessed by it, take it for them. So that way it goes to a good place. And also after the service, after the invitation, we'll meet downstairs for our Lord's Supper. So just keep that in mind as we go through the service this morning. Let's grab our songbooks one more time and go to number 89. Let's all stand, please, as we prepare for our scripture reading to follow. Number 89, Does Jesus Care? Does Jesus Care? What a precious hymn. Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song? As the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary and strong. Let's sing the first, second, and the fourth verse of number 89. Number 89, Does Jesus Care? Think of the words as you sing.
Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song? As the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary and long. Oh, yes. He cares, I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care? When my way is dark with a nameless dread and fear, as the daylight fades into deep night shades, does he care enough to be near? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care? When I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me, and my sad heart aches till it nearly breaks. Is it aught to him? Does he see? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares.
I'm so glad we serve a Savior that does care. Amen. Let's grab our Bibles. We're going to go to the book of 2 Timothy in the New Testament. 2 Timothy chapter 2, as Brother Tony makes his way up here. 2 Timothy chapter 2, I want to recognize our visitors who are with us. Brother Paso, I believe we have David here, if I'm remembering right. And then is that Tara? And then your daughter, I forgot your name. Abby, okay. And then David and? Say it again. Derek, okay. And then on your row, Brother Paso? Corey, that's right. Scott? Good. Glad to have you here. Glad to have you here. I recognized some faces, and I knew there was a David, and I recognized Corey, but I was getting confused with David. Anyways, thanks for coming. It's always glad to have you. We hope that you feel right at home here. So thanks for being here. It does our heart good. Amen. Let's grab our Bibles and go to 2 Timothy chapter 2. Brother Tony, please come. He's going to come and lead us in our scripture reading from 2 Timothy chapter 2.
Good morning. Welcome to Harvest Baptist Church. If you're wondering why Miss Christy and Sarah are smiling, it's because I bought Christy's son, Ethan, a brand new kazoo. You know, who doesn't like a kazoo? So if you hear a melodic, musical thing going on after church, it's Ethan. And I have one too. So actually, when I bought it at Five Below, I asked for the kazoo section, David. You know what I mean? Everybody has a kazoo section. So I went there, and I asked the salesperson, the lady. I said, who doesn't like a kazoo? And she looked at me for about 3 seconds and said, me. Moms don't like kazoo. This is perfect. I'm getting this for Ethan. So anyway, so open your Bibles to 2 Timothy. Didn't think we'd be talking about kazoos, did you, David? 2 Timothy chapter 2, we'll be reading verses 1 through 13. I will begin, and you respond accordingly. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he is not crowned, except he strive lawfully. The husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. Verse 13 together. If we believe not, yet he abide faithful, he cannot deny himself. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word this morning, Lord, out of 2 Timothy. What a great reminder, Lord. Reminds us in there, if we deny you, you deny us, Lord. May we not deny you, Lord. Help us to stand. Give us a strong backbone to stand for righteousness in our society today, where evil seems to be on full display wherever you go, Lord. And our flesh wants to do wrong. That's the way our flesh is. It desires things we shouldn't go after, Lord. Help us to stand for righteousness, to represent Christ as we leave here today. Give our pastor what he needs to give to us today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Here's my life, take every part. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Help me draw so close to you that your love comes shining through. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Make me a witness like you, dear Lord, showing the love of the cross, sharing your word till all have heard, serving whatever the cost. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Here's my life, take every part. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Help me draw so close to you that your love comes shining through. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart. Help me draw so close to you that your love comes shining through. Give me, Lord, a servant's heart.
Girls, let's turn in our Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, this is a very familiar passage of Scripture. Here we see the Apostle Paul speaking to his son in the faith, Timothy. Timothy was a preacher boy of Paul's, and he worked with him in the ministry. In verse 1, we see that Paul is commanding Timothy to be strong in the grace that is in Jesus. Verse 2, he says, "And the thing that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." Here Paul is commanding Timothy to be a good listener. He says, "The things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, be a good listener." Then he says, "Be a good understander. The same commit thou to faithful men." If you're going to commit something to faithful men, you've got to be able to understand it. And then he says, I want you to be a good teacher. He says, who shall be able to teach others also. He wanted him to take the truths that he had given him and pass them down. Verse 3, he talks about how there are some realities to understand when it comes to serving the Lord. He talks about how hard it is. It's like being a soldier. If you are called to battle, or if you've ever read some stories from those that served in World War II, it's hard. Being a good soldier is hard. Verse 4 says, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life." When you are a soldier, when you are serving the Lord, some realities is that is focused. You have to remain untangled. And it's for the purpose. Look at the end of verse 4, it says, "That he may please him who had chosen him to be a soldier." It's for the purpose of pleasing your master. In verse 10 through 12, he says, "Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake." He goes on to explain some of his trials and some of the things that he has gone through to Timothy, this young preacher. And in verse 13, he talks about the nature of God. Let's look at verse 10, it says, "Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us." Then this is what I want us to get to, this verse here. "If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful." If
for he cannot deny himself. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Heavenly Father, I praise and thank you, Lord, for this time that you've given us to come together. Help us, Lord, as we look at this scripture, and Lord, as we continue our study on the fruit of the Spirit, Lord, please teach us something. Help us, Lord, to see this in you. Help us, Lord, to see how what we can do, Lord. We may not be able to be great people or have a large church or have a great ministry, but Lord, we all can be faithful. We can all be in our place. We can all be what we ought to be. And Lord, I ask that you please help us, Lord, to see this in you and to see how you're faithful to us and how we ought to be faithful to others. Lord, pray you please help me to help. Lord, I know that there are folks with burdens. There are folks with aching hearts. I pray that you please help me, Lord, to be able to say something or as I'm speaking, be speaking to their hearts and meeting their needs. Lord, I need your help. Hide me behind the cross of Jesus. Rebuke the evil one. I pray that you please rebuke the evil one, that he would not be able to distract anyone, that the Holy Spirit would have full and free reign. Holy Spirit, please fill this place with your power, with your presence. We need this. We need you. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness. This goodness is tempered by grace. This goodness makes him approachable. This goodness requires a person's time and talents and interests and strengths and energies and capacities for the purpose of enriching the lives of others. And it will demand that I set aside my own selfish interests in order to give to others. You may say, I can't be used of God to do that. You don't know what I've done. Well, when the Holy Spirit enters our little lives to shed abroad God's love in our hearts, we become a changed people. And old things are passed away. All things are become new. We can be good to others. We can show off the goodness of God because the guilt of our past is gone. Our sins have been washed under the blood of Jesus. All things are passed away. All things are become new. There's no need for me to feel inferior or superior to others. There's no need for a phony facade. There's no need for me to feel that I've got to compete with another brother or sister in Christ. I'm accepted in the beloved. I can feel secure in his promises. I can feel secure in his word. I can act with a humble and approachable spirit that is ready and eager to reach out with God's goodness and touch others who are also struggling in life. And when his character fills me, when his spirit fills me, I will be overcome with generosity. I will find it easy to give of myself for the sake of giving, not getting. People who are generous are not afraid to love. They're not afraid to let go. That's what happens when the Holy Spirit enters our lives and sheds abroad God's love in our hearts. We become a changed people. How can one become good with the goodness of God? Come to Calvary again. Remember what was done for you there. Spend time thinking about the cross and the suffering and the shame that Jesus bore for you there. Cry out to him and ask him to invade the territory of your little life. Ask him to be the good gardener. Ask him to do a work in your heart and to tend and care for your soul. Ask God to cultivate you. Ask God to do surgery on your heart. If there's bitterness there, ask God to help you conquer that. If there's hurt, if there's pain from something of the past, ask God. Talk to God about that. I was talking to somebody this morning. I say, you know what? God gave us gossip. How many times have you heard preachers preach against gossip? You see, we use gossip in the wrong way. We direct gossip at another human instead of him. That's who we're supposed to be gossiping to. If we got a problem with somebody, we need to go to him and ask him and tell him about that and have him heal our hearts and have him act the right way toward that person. And then he will take care of that person instead of depositing it to another human who can do nothing about it, but then pass it to somebody else and pass it to somebody else and pass. And then he hopefully gets to somebody mature who will give it to God. But that's what God has given us. He wants to cultivate us. He wants to work with us. He wants to have our hearts and lives changed. But we've got to cry out to him and ask him, invade my life. Come and change me. There was a time where in my own personal life, I felt like there were some things that I needed to learn. But I felt like my faith wasn't there to be able to do what my mind was dreaming of or thinking of doing, contemplating. So I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, I don't know if you ever remember that old movie called What About Bob? What about, anyways. Somebody showed it to me years ago. I was probably 12, 13 years old. And the thing about that movie was, you remember that? You remember that? Babe steps, babe steps, babe steps, babe steps, babe steps, babe steps. That was the perv, this psychiatric guy who was following his psychiatrist on this vacation. His psychiatrist kept telling him, take babe steps, babe steps, babe steps. And that's what I prayed to the Lord. Lord, in my mind, I see, and I'm scared of what I'm imagining in my mind, take me in baby steps. God will take you in baby steps. He'll inch you along. He'll inch you along, but you've got to cry out to him and ask him, do this work in my heart. Cultivate me. And as he lives in you and you in him, keep the ground of your life clear and clean and uncluttered. Don't let sin be mounting up and growing in your life. If the Lord has convicted your heart about something that you shouldn't be doing, get it right with him. Go to him. Talk to him about it. Keep the account short. And then as you are keeping it clear, keep your relationship with the Holy Spirit. Keep it strong. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Obey the Holy Spirit's promptings. Obey it happily. Obey it humbly. Obey it heartily. Then remind yourself that you are the recipient and not the originator of every gift and attribute that you possess. You may have all kinds of riches around you, but it wasn't because of you that is with you. Deuteronomy says that the Lord has given us power to get wealth. It's the Lord who gives us power to get wealth. So be grateful. Be grateful for his generous graciousness that he gives to you. And so we come to the next fruit of the Spirit, faith. Alongside of God's love itself, faith is the most frequently discussed facet of the Christian life. But rather than being something distinct and apart from God's love, it's a very integral part of it. You see, faith is a facet of selflessness. God's love is selflessness. And faith is a facet or a different face of it. You see, faith by its very nature implies that I can see good in another outside myself. I can see this good in God himself, or I can see the good in others around me. And this seeing, this appreciating, this recognizing the value of in another implies that I am reaching out with my mind and I am handling that good in another. Faith is also my deliberate and positive response to the good that I see in another and my choice to act on their behalf in a personal and powerful way. It means I'm willing to share my life and my capacities, my time, my strength, my attention, my affection with another. It means that I actively and energetically give my best to another outside of myself and apart from myself, expecting nothing in return, because I am doing this by faith. You know, that Sunday morning when the Lord confirmed in my heart that my wife, Melissa Osborne, would be the one that I would marry. You know, I went home and I did business with the Lord, and I said that morning, said, Lord, by faith, I believe that you've confirmed in my heart that this is the woman that I need to marry. So by faith, I receive her. And I'm going to serve her. I didn't know what the future held. But by faith, I knew God wanted me to serve her. And God wanted me to be in her life. And that's what God wants us. When we are thinking about another person. And we're seeing good in another person. And then we say, by faith, I'm going to start getting involved. And be actively involved in this person. It's you doing good to them because it's the right thing to do, not because you're hoping for something in return. If you're hoping for something in return, you're not going to do it for very long. You're going to be disappointed. Your expectations are not going to be fulfilled. It's just a matter of truth. You've got to go and do this and give them your best, expecting nothing in return. The Bible teaches us that God has dealt to every man a measure of faith. And when challenged by Jesus to make forgiving a lifestyle instead of being offended over every little slight, the disciples, trying to mentally grasp how this was going to stretch them from being short-tempered, angry fishermen and conniving, cheating tax collectors and fiery patriot zealots, sadly said, increase our faith. But God has given to every man a measure of faith. And he says, I want you to use it. I want you, something that we need to understand about faith is that when we invest it in the right thing, it's going to grow. It's going to grow. The source of our faith is, as we read last week, Hebrews 12:2, looking unto Jesus, the author of our faith. It's the heart of Jesus. That's the source of our faith. That this faith that springs out of the heart of Jesus will cause me to give myself to others in faithfulness when they're present. I'll get in the yoke with them. I'll join them in what they're doing because I have faith in the good that they're doing and I can see it. I can see that what they're doing is going to do good for the society or for them personally. And so I get in with them and I'm faithful to them. I show support for what they're doing. I'm not opposing their agenda. How many times have you talked to a farmer and they say if they are using horses to plow, that the horses, they need to be a good team. Because if they're not a good team, you may have a short-legged horse or a short-legged beast and a tall, long-legged beast, and one takes few strides or take his normal stride, and the other one's having to run just to keep up. They're not a good team. So you, as someone who has faith and are faithful to a person when they're present, you get in their yoke and you don't pull them back. You don't oppose their agenda. You see, this faith that springs out of the heart of Jesus will cause me to show fidelity to them when they are absent, when they're not present with me. I will show fidelity to them. I will continue my commitment with my words to them. I won't just say the words that please their ears when they are near, but my words will be backed up by my actions when they are away. I'm going to show fidelity. I'm going to continue my active participation and wholehearted effort in their plan. I'm not going to sabotage their efforts or their progress. And I'm not going to try to steal any of the credit when they're not there. I'm going to be faithful to them. This faith that springs out of the heart of Jesus will cause me to give myself to others in not only faithfulness when they're present and fidelity when they're absent, but also unyielding loyalty when they're disparaged or under attack or even going astray. I'll stand up for them when negative things are spoken about them. I'll stand with them when negative news is swirling around. And I'll stand in front of them to deflect an attack directed at them. And I'll also stand up to them when they are dabbling in negative things. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. I'll be a faithful friend. I will wound my friend if it means sparing his life, but I won't leave my friend afterwards. That's faithfulness. Why? Why do I give myself to people in my life in that way? It's because I see the good in them, and I deliberately respond to that good in a personal and powerful way. Didn't God do that with us? He saw some good in us. He saw that maybe, just maybe, some good would come out of our life. This is faith, the facet of God's love, which finds me giving myself to others in faithfulness when they're present, fidelity when they're absent, and unyielding loyalty when they're disparaged or under attack or going astray. And when I demonstrate my faith in this way, that faith is expressed in a constant and continuous investment in both God and man of all that I am and all that I own. That's what we can strive to be as a man. But Proverbs says, a faithful man who can find. If you want to see this caliber of faith, you cannot look to man or woman. See, that's where it trips us up. As we try to look at it in other people, we're sure to be disappointed. We're sure to be, when you look at a fellow Christian, you're looking at a sinner. You're looking at a person who struggles with sin. If all of your eyes are pointed to the pulpit this morning, you're looking at a person who struggles with sin, who is a sinner, who is a fallen creature. I shouldn't be up here speaking to anybody. I should be listening to Jesus and listening to the Holy Spirit preach to us. But he's asked me to fill this position. So I do. If you want to see this caliber of faith, you cannot look to man or woman. You have to look to God himself. Lamentations says, great is thy faithfulness. Just as his love and his kindness and long-suffering and goodness emanate and exude and flow from him in an eternal and unending stream to us, so his faithfulness flows to us, undiminished every day. But when I contemplate, when I think about his great faithfulness, some questions come to mind. Why does this omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God, who is righteous and impeccable in character, why does he think it worth his time or effort to have faith in us? We're a feeble, frail, and a failing human race. Why does he have faith in us? Another question, how can he who is so magnified and so grand and great in comparison to our tiny little mortal lives? Have you ever seen a picture of the universe? Somebody did a PowerPoint presentation, and they were showing the size of the universe. And when they got to what the telescopes could take a picture of the universe, Earth was so small that you had to take a pixel of the computer screen and magnify it 1,000 times to then take a pixel of that computer screen and magnify it 1,000 times to take a pixel of that computer screen and we were so insignificant, it was pathetic. But we think we're all big, bad, and tough. Why would God, who is that big, pay so much time and so much attention to microscopic amoebas like us? Think about it. If you were to look at a bacteria on a microscope, you'd have to magnify it how many times? And that's what God has to do just to be able to see our lives. He has to magnify. He's like, man, y'all are so tiny. Why does he do that? Why does he even bother to bestow himself and all his benefits upon us? Does it make any sense? How can he be so gracious, so generous, and so good to share himself with such an unpredictable people who in turn are so often unfaithful to him and to their fellow humans? They're sobering and searching questions. There are two simple answers to those probing questions. And so we turn to our text passage in 2 Timothy chapter 2. It says in verse 8, remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Why does an omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God think it worth his time to have faith in us as a failing, feeble, and frail human race? How can he who is so grand and great and magnified in comparison to our tiny microscopic selves, well, how can he be so faithful to us? Why does he bother to bestow himself and his benefits upon us? Why is he so gracious and so generous and so good to share himself with an unpredictable people, with an unpredictable race, who are unfaithful to him and unfaithful to each other? The first answer is this. Number one, the nature of God himself. You see, why does this omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God think it worth his time to have faith in us? Because of the nature of God himself. It says, he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. It's just who he is. How can he who is so magnified in comparison to our tiny mortal lives be faithful to us? Because of the nature of God himself. He abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Why does he even bother to bestow his benefits upon us? It's because of the nature of God himself. He abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. How can he be so gracious and so generous and so good and share himself with us and offer us a home in heaven because he's so faithful? He cannot deny himself. It's his nature. He abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Hold your place there in 2 Timothy. Take your Bibles and go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians, a couple books over. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Listen to what Paul said about God. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 9. Say the first three words with me. Ready?
1 Corinthians 1, chapter 1, verse 9. Say amen if you have it.
Yeah.
Amen. Ready? God is faithful. That's what Paul said. Go to chapter 10 of that same book. Chapter 10, verse 13. Read it with me. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. It says, there hath no, say it out loud with me, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man, but God is faithful. God is faithful. Moses said in Deuteronomy 7, he says, know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, the faithful God. You see, the first and foremost answer to these probing questions is his own inherent righteousness, justice, integrity, and holiness. God is so wholesome. God is so good. God is so selfless that he cannot be anything else but faithful. He's that way because that's his very makeup. You see, if for no other reason, he must inevitably be faithful and true to himself. He is very truth. Hence, he cannot act except in utter good faith. Because this is so, it explains why he comes to us in goodwill. It explains why he comes to us in peace. It explains why he comes to us eagerly to pour this same attribute of his own character into our little lives. He yearns to share this self-giving capacity with us, a selfish and self-centered people. Why? With profound longing, he waits to see this fruit of his own spirit spring to life in us. He waits patiently to see it ripen and mature into active living faith of obedience that is reciprocated back to him and out to others. You see, the reason he is prepared to do all this is not because of what we may be initially. It's not because he sees something good in us that makes him act that way to us. Remember, Psalms 14 says, there's none that doeth good, no, not one. Paul said, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The reason he is prepared to do all this is not because of what we may be initially, but because of what we may become. Amen. It's what he can do in us. That's where he has faith in us. That's why he has faith in us, because he knows that when he comes into our little lives, he can change us from night to day. It's what we may become. Can you see the faith in God's heart as he views us? That's why God says, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together, come to church. Hear what my word has to say to you, because I want to plant the seed of my word in your heart. Every time the doors are open, I want to plant the seed of my word, in your heart. And God says, I want to see that seed. I want to see it change your life. I have faith in you. He sees within us the capacity to be conformed to his own character. Can you believe that? He sees that capacity. Maybe we look in ourselves, maybe we look in the mirror and we see a person that we're not happy with, but God looks at us and he sees the capacity for us to be like him. You see, he who made us knows that under the impulse of his own gracious spirit and the divine direction of his own living word, Jesus living in us, we can become his sons and his daughters, adopted into his family and maturing into his very likeness, the likeness of Jesus Christ. That's why he has faith in us. See, this is not theoretical theology. It's not divine doctrine. It does happen in human hearts and lives. We can be reborn. We can be recreated. We can be made into men and women whose character, whose conduct, and whose conversation look just like Jesus Christ. Go with me to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 15, it says, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh,
Yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All things are become new. We can be reborn. We can be recreated. Why? Because that's what God can do. He has faith in us. He knows that whenever he begins to work in our lives, it will have a positive change. We can be made into the men and women whose character, conduct, and conversation look just like Jesus Christ. And because this is possible, God finds joy in being faithful to us. Joy in being faithful to us. He is confident of what he can achieve and accomplish by working in the garden of our little lives. You see, he can tear out the old bramble and briars. You see, he can clear the ground of rocky unbelief and bitterness. You see, he can break up the hard-packed pathways. He can open us up to receive the good seed of his own winsome word. And all of this he does with unfailing goodwill and unending faithfulness. We can be made into the men and women whose character, conduct, and conversation look just like Jesus Christ because he has faith in us. He cannot deny himself. He abideth faithful. Heavenly Father, I thank you and praise you, Lord, for this grand truth that you've showed us from your word. I'm so glad that you're so faithful. We're so microscopic and minuscule in comparison to you. Yet you love us. Yet you're faithful to us. We're your creation and you're faithful to us. Heavenly Father, I pray you, please help us to understand how much you love us and allow the seed of your word to be deposited into our hearts so that it can produce a positive change and it can make us look more like Jesus Christ. That's what the word of God can do. Why would you waste your time to bother with us? It's because of your faithfulness. It's just who you are. And you have confidence in your ability to make us look like you. And for that, we thank you. I pray, Heavenly Father, please help us, Lord, as your children, to desire you to make a change in our hearts. Heal our hearts. Heal our hearts from the hurtful memories. Heal our hearts from the hurtful things said in the events of the past. Take the ache and the pain away. Leave only a painless memory. Do a work in our hearts to where we can grow and we can be more like Christ. And serve you and please you with our life, with our actions. Heavenly Father, please draw us close to you. Shine Jesus Christ through our lives more and more. Show the world how faithful you are. Make us your trophies of grace because of your faithfulness. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for that. Thank you for taking the time to work with us. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand, please. We have Miss Melissa play a hymn of invitation. The altar's open. Why don't you come down and just thank the Lord for his faithfulness to you? Despite struggles you may have had or despite mistakes of the past, yet he abideth faithful. Yet he abideth faithful. We have a loving Heavenly Father, and he wants to work with us. And he invests so much in us because it's just his nature. He loves his creation and he loves you. Why don't you come and tell him? Let's pray.
Let's grab our songbooks and go to number 270. Number 270, we'll sing the first and last verse of Just As I Am, Just As I Am. Number 270. This will be our closing hymn. Number 270, we'll sing the first and last verse. Join me on the first.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come.
Take just a second, just bow your heads as the pianist continues to play. Do you know for sure that Jesus Christ is your Savior? Do you know that Jesus Christ is your Savior? Are you 100% sure that when you die that you're going to go to heaven? God is faithful. He will save you if you call on Him. Everyone must understand that we're all sinners, that we're not perfect. Everyone must understand that because of our sin, there's a price to be paid, and that's death and hell. And that's why Jesus came to take our place. He came to be born of a virgin, live a perfect life, be a perfect sacrifice, so that He could pay for our sins by His death, burial, and resurrection. Shed His blood to cover our sins, to put on the mercy seat up in heaven. And anyone who will call on Him, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. Do you know for sure that when you die that you're going to go to heaven? You can know that for sure. 1 John 5:13 says that we can know that we have eternal life. We don't have to wonder. We can know that we have eternal life. If you're standing here, you don't know for sure. You can get that settled right here, right now, right where you are. You don't have to come to the altar. Right where you are, you could pray and ask Jesus to save you. He abideth faithful. If you call on Him right now and ask Him for that salvation, ask Him to forgive you of your sins, ask Him to be your Savior, ask Him to come into your heart, ask Him to take you to heaven when you die, He is faithful. He will fulfill. He will answer your prayer. He will give you what you ask. Whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If there's anybody here who's doubting about their salvation, and you would like to know for sure that you have Jesus as your Savior, pray this simple prayer to Jesus. Right where you are, just say, Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of all my sin. Please come into my heart and save me. Please take me to heaven when I die. Thank you, Jesus, for paying my price for my sin on the cross of Calvary, for being buried, for raising again, for giving me eternal life. I receive you and you alone as my one and only Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for being faithful to your promise and to your word. Pray this in your name. Amen. If you, my friend, prayed that prayer and asked Jesus to come into your heart, you asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins, God is faithful to His word. He cannot deny Himself. He says in His word, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not might be, shall be. It's a definite. John 3:16, a very famous verse, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If you believe on Him, He says you should not perish. You won't perish. You won't die and go to a sinner's hell. You'll be able to go to heaven. Because why? Because you believed on the only begotten Son of God. And that's salvation. And God is faithful to His word. It doesn't matter what you've done in the past. He already saw it. He already witnessed it. He's ready to forgive. He just wants you to come and give Him that permission. Give Him the open door that is okay with you. Let him pay for your sins. Take Jesus' righteousness upon you and let him take your sins. He's willing to trade that. Can you believe that? He's willing to trade his righteousness and give it to you for your sins, but you have to give it to him. You can't say, no, I'm going to pay for it. No, I'm going to pay. No, you pay for it, Jesus. And that's what, when you ask Jesus to come into your heart, you're asking him, pay for my sins, my past, present, and future sins. And when a person does that, the Bible says that that person's saved. That person's saved. Let's sing the last verse of our closing hymn, number 270. Join me on the last, on the fifth verse.
Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come, I come.
Amen. Just like the title of this song, just as I am, I come, I come. That's how God will take you in your present condition. Because he cannot deny himself. He abideth faithful. He cannot be anything but faithful. And if you fulfill one of God's promises and you fulfill God's word, he has to keep his end of the bargain. And he has to keep his end of the promise. If anybody will call on the name of the Lord, God says, shall be saved. He can't deny himself. Aren't you glad about that? Aren't you glad about that? You don't have to worry, am I good enough? Am I good looking enough? Am I helpful enough? Have I done enough? And you're always in that limbo. No, his promises say, do this and I'll do this. And I'm faithful. I'm faithful to my word. I cannot deny myself. I'm glad I serve a God like that. Amen. Let's bow. For prayer after prayer, we're going to head downstairs for our Lord's Supper. If you would like to join us, you feel free to join us downstairs. We'll just gather around the walls and have a short little time of observing the Lord's Supper. Probably one of our last times to have it downstairs. But we'll be down there shortly after the dismissal prayer. So if you want to join us, please join us. All right, let's bow for prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Brother Gere, do you mind dismissing us, please?